stand up, come closer, and also sit next to somebody who is not from your, say, state or territory, ideally. Ideally, you want to be in a conversation with somebody from a very different team.
Wait, it was catching up.
Awesome. Okay, thanks everybody. Hi, I'm Max. For those who don't know me, I'm currently co-coach for the Australian Under-24 Knicks team. Yay! Who'll be representing Australia in Perth in January. Also captain of Brisky, current mixed national champions, and you'll hear a okay, so first just want to quickly address the name. I wanted something a little bit interesting, but I think the idea of winning spirit, and Potsy's not here to argue this in person with me, but it's, it's arguably a bit of a misnomer. I don't want us to be thinking about this concept as teaching to the test, per se, and getting really good at spirit with the specific purpose of getting good results. And part of the reason of that is the reason that I think you should care about spirit is more to do with the game and your personal enjoyment of it. But let's say your team gets together and you've had a values and goals chat and you've said something like, let's win spirit at X tournament. How do you go about actually doing it? So we're going to try and mix the practical and the nice little floppy stuff that everybody loves. Okay, so why should you care? This is the only reason I really play Ultimate Frisbee. I've been doing this for 10 plus years now, which is outrageous. But the only thing that's kept me playing is that spirit cuts out all the bullshit that you, excuse my French, that is often in other sports. The basic enjoyment of the game is 100% tied to the ideals of spirit. And I don't think many people have played a poorly spirited game that they've enjoyed, which probably tells you something about why enjoyment and spirit are directly linked. Something, you know, thousand body contacts is an important part of spirit that we'll get to later. Safety, being well-spirited is also attached to safety, injury prevention, all that stuff. As I said, we wouldn't be here as a group of people, and we wouldn't have such amazing presentations. Like, I have Dead Set welled up in 3 presentations today. And we wouldn't have that experience if we didn't have spirit. So I think that's totally awesome. One thing that I'll get to a little bit later, I think spirit is an amazing recruitment tool. Part of that is that it improves the spectator enjoyment of the sport. Getting rid of refs is actually something that can be quite, actually can be quite a benefit, I think, for spectators if we get the mechanics of it right. That's a conversation for the pub later on. But you know, this thing that your physio Mish shared on social media that's been all over the place. We build better people when we build better spirited athletes. So I basically think it's the best. This is my team from Kaimana. I think it's worth saying that I think you actually have a responsibility as a coach to teach spirit and to put it at the forefront of what you're doing. It's rule number one in our game, and to ignore it is actually, you know, ceding some responsibility that you should have as a coach. So, although it's fun and I want you to view it basically as a responsibility, but it's also a great opportunity. There are so, you know, when you think about why you coach, I think part of it is related to spirit of the game, maybe if you haven't necessarily bridged that link. But all the things you talk about when you're talking about building, you know, better human beings and, you know, putting your energy out into the community, part of it, what you're doing is actually because Spirit of the Game enables us to teach some really amazing concepts around, you know, conflict resolution and being, you know, more engaged athletes at a societal level as well. So, what is Spirit? Oh man, it's gone on two lines. Embarrassing. Would anyone like to throw out something? Now, I'll give you a little bit of a guideline, I guess. What do you think the most crucial element of Spirit is? Or maybe, what's the most important aspect as a coach that you would like to impart upon others?
Trust that no one's intentionally grabbing
you. Cool. So,
trust in your opponents.
Integrity, I guess, maybe would be a way to describe that. Sorry, respect. Yeah, absolutely. Really, really important is respectful. Everybody, opponents. Yep. Great. Fair-mindedness. Yeah. Would you like to expand on that at all? Yeah, absolutely. Great. So, yeah. Yeah, knowing, trying to put yourself in someone else's shoes, empathy.
Joy.
Great. So glad you mentioned joy.
Adrenaline.
Okay, so before we get to the definition, I thought it would be worth just one really interesting thing is, you know, I've done a few presentations now and tried to think about how other sports view these concepts. One really hard thing is to try and think about how other sports view something like Spirit of the Game in terms of their own sporting cultures. It's actually one of the reasons why it's so cool that we have it, because us as adults can sit around in a room and talk about something that's like quite important to how we are as human beings. Not many other sports would have a session like this, unless you're talking about teaching youth athletes. But maybe that also gives you a sense that because this is something that we want to teach our kids, maybe it's something that we, you know, should reflect on a little bit more. And in part to everybody who we teach. It's an amazing opportunity, I guess, to teach people of university age or another age group something that's so integral to being kind of a nice and good and better person. I imagine. The formulation that I really loved that USA Soccer teaches a lot of their youth athletes is this Roots idea. So it's exactly that fair-mindedness and respect. It's having respect for the rules, officials, opponents, teammates, and yourself. Some of this actually breaks down quite nicely when you start looking at how we've developed our own spirit criteria. But some of how you might attack coaching spirit might actually be tied to some of these categories if you didn't want to go down the traditional path of teaching in our five categories. These might give you some ways to get in, especially with really young athletes, how you teach respect, breaking it down in terms of who you're giving respect to. You know, whether it's the rules, your opponents, officials, teammates, and stuff. I love this from tennis, that this comes up again and again. People talk about looking the other person in the eye when you shake their hand. Maybe a lot of people from other sports might have experienced this before in general, but I find it so fascinating that this is, like, we're so privileged to be in a community where this seems really basic. But some of the basics really do matter, and hopefully we'll get to that a little bit later in the presentation. I want to play this video. Tell me if you've seen it before.
We put a huge premium on body language.
care how good you are. If somebody says, well, you know, you just benched Stewie for, you know, 35 minutes in the Memphis game a couple years ago. Yeah, I did. Oh, that was the motivator for the South Carolina game the following Monday. No, it wasn't. Stewie was acting like a 12-year-old. So I put her on the bench and said, sit there. It doesn't matter on that team. And the other coach might say, well, you can do that, but you got three other, you know, all of them. I did that. I understand. But I'd rather lose than watch kids party boys than this way. I'd rather lose.
I love that. And that's really interesting for me because you might not instantly make the connection that that is related to spirit, potentially.
Still playing.
Oh, yeah.
Presenting.
You might not make the connection that that's related to spirit, but, you know, something I'm going to talk a little about is how body language is important. And it tells you something in terms of inculcating the basic joy of play is actually something amazing as a recruitment tool, as a tool for, you know, encouraging your teammates and your players. Teaching good spirit is really multifaceted, and it's an amazing self-recruitment tool because, you know, you've got amazing people like Holly, for example, sorry, Holly, to call you out, but like amazing juniors who are already giving back to the community because of some of the basic joy that they've experienced playing the game. Not to put words in your mouth, Holly, but... okay, cool. So let's have a look at the actual words from the rules because it might be worth refreshing. I always skip over this part when I'm doing the rules quiz, obviously. But I've highlighted some of the key points from this. So one of them you brought up is that the basic joy of play is something that we're trying to focus on, I guess, when we have spirit of the game as the core of what we do. The rules are obviously important. Every player has a responsibility to be fair. Fair is a really key word there. It shouldn't sacrifice competitiveness, so that you should feel that. And respect is really important. That goes towards the fair-mindedness. Having respect for yourself, having respect for your opponents, having respect for R-O-O-T-S, etc. Cool. That's directly from the rules, if you're wondering. And you want to look it up later? Okay, cool. So these are the big five. You know them probably from Wolfdorf Spirit Scoring Sheet, if you've ever done this one before. Can I recommend... Oh, great. I'm glad you brought a Spirit Scoring Sheet with you. Please give me a rating after this. Five stars. There's one document, if you only had to go away and read one thing after this, Wolfdorf publishes, there's a one A4 page in English that is behaviours that might describe getting a 0 to a 4 in each of these five categories. So it's a grid, very simple, and it's incredibly comprehensive in terms of giving you some ideas for what good-spirited behaviour is. Rob has it, in fact, laminated right now, so yeah. Maybe we'll read the prompt or whatever. But the good thing is I'm about to list a bunch of these things. So I'm going to go through each of these five categories. What I'm going to put up on the screen, I'm basically going to try and now just dump a bunch of ideas on you for how you can practically go out and coach spirit in each of these five categories. I really want to encourage discussion, and I'll probably have some pauses to do that, to give you some opportunities. But what we're going to get to at the end is also a framework for how you actually choose which ones to do. Because I think I'm going to give you a bunch of ideas, and some of them will stick for individuals, and some of them will be like, that's unachievable, I've already done that, or whatever else. At the end, I'm going to talk a little bit about a framework for how you choose. So this is, we're going big to go small in a little bit at the end of the present. Cool. So let's start with rules, knowledge, and use. The behaviours that are coming up on the left, these are all behaviours that the spirit guidelines suggest represent good spirit. So knowing the rules, speaking to time limits, everything you see here, these are the behaviours that we want to hold up as exemplary spirit as per the Wolfdorf rules. And also, they all sound really good. So it's not just words on a page, it's actually pretty important. So some overarching points on rules, knowledge, and use. Australia is pretty good at it. In terms, if we're looking at a international level, traditionally we've gotten very high scores in this category. Richard is nodding, so take that as a yes. There's a lot of structural incentives to be good at it, aka rules accreditation demands at national tournaments and things like that. That's not to say that we can't get better at it. The rules quiz is something simple that lots of teams already do and you may be forced to do because of the level that you're playing at. So that's kind of nice. A lot of this stuff is built in. What I want to go to, I guess, is some of the other elements of it. So sticking to time limits is maybe something that you don't necessarily associate with rules knowledge and use. But actually being efficient in between points is a really good way for you as a coach to be well-spirited and to have a well-spirited team. You know, as a player that's standing around waiting for another team to make some decisions or whatever can really deflate your sense of enjoyment in a game. As best practice, don't do that. Have a plan for in-between points that encourages you to be on time, basically, and to make sure that you're not taking an unreasonable amount of time. Consider putting rules at the center of, a training for a small portion. So think about having sessions that focus on a particular rule. You may do that with an actual drill where you, talk about marking violations, for example, is a good category that you might use to put a focus on a particular rule. And consider, even if it's just one person presenting, this may offer a leadership opportunity to somebody to come in and say, we're going to have player A is going to present for 1 minute on rule X at this training. Do a list up at the start of the season, everybody goes through one rule, boom. At least more visibility. Practice onside pulls at trainings. On rules focus as well, another really common strategy is to give license to certain players to commit fouls, to have people call them. I think that's a perfectly viable option. Another option may be just to ensure that all calls are litigated at training. So, and I'm going to get to that a little bit later. Cool, fouls and body contact. Again, good behaviours coming in here. Fouls and body contact is interesting because if we're talking spirit scoring specifically, it's a really hard category to actually get a good score in. It's much easier to recognise moments of poor body control and fouls and body contact than it is to recognise good moments. Australia, if we're talking about a national level and international tournaments, we've also traditionally gotten below average scores in this category, although I'd say that's probably changing slightly now. And maybe that's a stylistic thing of Australian Ultimate.
I know that we're below the average when for the categories average, but are we below average relative to all the other countries? Because I noticed when looking at a summary of that pretty much every country gets below two in this category. So do you know how we fare compared to all the other countries?
I'll take Mish's.
Yeah, from my experience being inside our communities, I think it's often a cultural difference, and we probably sit somewhere in the middle of many of the Asian countries in terms of how much contact will we accept, what we think is within and out, acceptable level here. Many of the Asian countries are much down one end, so less contact is better in their countries. We're probably in the middle, and then there are obviously some countries that are comfortable with more contact, particularly US and Canada, I think, are generally more comfortable with more contact. And so I think a lot of that depends on who you're matching up against and whether you can adjust your level to the country you're playing. So maybe it's that we're not so good at adjusting it rather than that we're one of the worst.
Yeah.
So, that, what we try to do with for this, because India traditionally does not have any contact, we avoid contact beautifully. I've seen a lot of, I know it sounds strange, but I've seen a lot of kids. So how we, especially when we go up against teams that we know have a lot of content in their style, like Canada, USA, sometimes Australia, but we don't have teams, right? I've never played Australia, but what we do is we tell the spirit captains to flag it right at the beginning. So spirit captains go and shake hands and we say, like, you know, we don't really have a lot of content, and so we go to all of the content.
Because that's exactly what I was going to say, basically, is this type of thing starts with a conversation, but, you know, one thing that's a really great point for everybody in this room is, you know, you don't often hear that the teams have a no-contact, like, bare minimum, right? You don't hear that in Australian teams, which might go some way to saying that internationally, we're on a certain level, and if you are looking to play internationally, that you may need to have that conversation that you need to do trainings where you have a zero-contact policy. Right? That's an option that you have as a coach to suggest or to work on in a drill type situation. Do you want to add?
Yeah, I think you hear a lot of people say, oh, you know, this team's a bit more comfortable with contact and I'm happy to, you know, they're happy with it and I'm happy to give a bit more. And so people are happy to match up to a, it sounds like you guys aren't, which I actually really like, but a lot of people talk about on an individual level and they're happy to match up as long as both people agree that it's cool. But how often are we having to match down? So if I was playing an Indian player, it's actually really important for me to be able to be like, okay, the standard that we are agreeing upon as players is actually here, and I need to be able to go down as well as be comfortable going.
Can I move up to you? What do you want?
Oh, let's just quickly, like, just adding to what we were saying. Is that from a coaching perspective, if we were, say, going up against Japan, have used people from, I don't know, America. Is that something from a coaching perspective where we go, all right, this game we need to tone it down, or is that something we need to adjust once we're already?
Yeah, great question. Can I park that?
Yeah,
and
sure.
I'll come back to it. Awesome. I'm going to talk about, I guess, expectations depending on what level you're playing at. But the really short answer is, I think you should prepare for it, and I think that you shouldn't necessarily expect something, but you need to be adaptable to it. So some things you can just go out and do. Practicing effectively establishing marks, I think, is really, really important. This is where a lot of thousand body contacts start. There's people crashing into people on the mark. We often say we're going to hack on the first second or two. I don't really think that's not something that I personally would coach, but practicing effectively establishing marks, I think, is really somewhere you can really target as a coach. Practicing laying out, not just on a beanbag or on the beach, but with other players in the spaces, I think is really, really important. Training beautiful layouts, basically. What I just said in terms of experimenting with different levels of contact of training, as Mish has suggested, we often go up and train to be more physical, but we don't often train to be completely non-physical. Try doing a netball style training where, I don't know if it's netball, it's a bad example. Try doing a training where you're not allowed to contact anybody at all, and if you do, it's a foul. Corfball style. Experiment with no contact allowed and see how your players adapt. Give them different inputs so it's not just going up but coming down as well. And most important, talk about contact together as a team. Even if you can, on a point-by-point or at a training level, per training. A really common example of a problem that will happen is that someone will commit a foul, maybe it won't, or someone will engage in a level of body contact which some players on the team are uncomfortable with. Then another player will call a foul with a similar level of body contact, and those two things will be not in agreement. I think that's going to happen, that different individuals will have different levels of contact that they are comfortable with, but at the same time, if you're a team competing, you're going to need to have some kind of agreed standard upon which to measure yourself. Part of playing a team sport is the agreement that you're buying into something as a group, and that actually requires a conversation to happen, and the best way to do it is to do it at training with actual examples. So, you know, a really good example, just the other day at training, Lado committed what I would say was too physical a D in the end zone. I was, the same thing then happened to me in another end zone, I didn't feel comfortable calling it because the level of contact had been established by Lado on that point to not be a foul per se, and I felt uncomfortable calling a foul because of the level of play that had been established. At training, you need to engage with that, maybe as a big group, maybe as a small group in a one-on-one situation, it depends on your team. But overall, at some point, you need to have that conversation to say, what's our agreed level of physical contact? And you're not going to get it right, but starting that dialogue might be a really effective step. I'll come back to this. Okay, so fair-mindedness. So these are some of the examples of stuff that's fair-minded. In addition to that, first, no unjustifiable, retaliatory, or tactical calls. You might also add something like calling only significant breaches, which probably fall into that kind of category. This kind of fair-mindedness category reaches somewhere to probably the nexus between spirit and your team culture and your team values. That's to do with consistency. I think one thing that could be really useful here is film review. As a group, if you have the capability, as a group, review footage of fouls, maybe in international games, for example, and have a discussion about whether you think it was a foul. Especially if you can start by using third-party examples that don't involve your own teammates, which might be a little bit less confrontational than, for example, if you reviewed one of your own games and had a discussion about whether you think X player or Y player should have called a foul. This might help you establish some kind of base in terms of what you think a good foul call is, and this conversation probably advances, moves you towards greater consistency, which I think is what we're all looking for. Yeah,
I think the retracted calls or advising teammates is really tricky. And also we're trying to train ourselves here in Australia to be better about not monitoring on the sideline. And I've just been playing Madison Heist in the US, and they have a really interesting way of helping on that one, where the sideline, when the call has been made by the teammate, the sideline will either put their hands on their heart to say, like, yeah, we'll be talking to this one. That looks pretty accurate. Or they put their hand on their head to say, we think you should think about this. And it's not actually saying,
make every call. Do it at training. Find a way for your teammates to communicate with you. You may do it in a variety of different ways. That's an awesome tip, like really cool. It may be as simple as just getting every player, every time there's a call, you have to look around and find someone else with an opinion, right? Make that an established part of what you do. It's not an unusual thing, it's the default, right? We should be asking our teammates for their opinion, and if their opinion is no opinion, fine. Right? But you need to start establishing physical pathways for people to do this stuff. Yes,
so on that one, and I'm sort of like half asking here, but I'm pretty sure other players on the field can jump in with opinion. The sideline shouldn't. But if you saw something and you think your teammate is wrong, it's okay to tell them.
Yeah, I totally agree, and I think part of the thing I'm trying to promote, I guess, is that people don't feel uncomfortable asking, and also it's not one of those situations where the person behind you has an opinion and is trying to chip in, but you're talking to the person. You should be just looking around. Like, simple physical movements can actually trigger really good benefits. Commonly try to no contest policy, so don't contest any call with the basic assumption that the other team is telling the truth. This has some follow-on things which I'll talk about in the next slide. But something like this gives you an idea of something you could try where you really do a radical experiment in assuming that the other person is telling the truth to the extent that people are capable, that there is a truth-based reality. Yes?
With the first one about not making unjustifiable, retaliatory, or tactical calls,
mm-hmm.
I understand how you do that, like, from your team's perspective, but if you that the other team is making like calls like that, how do you have that discussion with your team without coming under the assumption that you think the other team is cheating? If we're supposed to be like defaulting to thinking that the other team is like being honest and truthful and fair, how do you decide then if they have been making like tactical calls without kind of like criticizing the other team for the way that they've been playing?
Yeah, short answer, control the controllables. And the other one would be use spirit captain capabilities within the structure to address that directly in the game as early as possible. Or captaincy if no spirit captain.
I think like as well as like giving people the benefit of the doubt, which is like what we're talking about. We also talk about like, you know, and everyone's probably aware of the concept of like calls not being context dependent like through a game. So I think it's like giving people the benefit of the doubt and taking the call on face value. So if you're talking to your team, I think about like, you know, that sort of thing, you don't necessarily have to say like, we know they're making like bad calls.
Yeah,
but you can say, remember to treat each call on face value.
Totally true. Really, there's a lot of communication cues that I think are really key. Okay, next slide. Positive attitude and self-control. The ones on the left, again, the behaviors that we're looking to generate. Pre-game and post-game rituals with other teams. This is one of the really good opportunity moments, and it's an opportunity for leadership. Give your spirit captains license to experiment with different ways and ways of interacting with another team. Consider some kind of pre-game thing that your team does with another team that promotes a better environment for the game to happen. Something like that could be really, really valuable. At one extreme, it might be like a dance that you guys do together. At a really low level, it may just be that you guys say, hey, we like to high-five our opponents before every game. No other team is going to say, no, we don't like to line up and high-five our opponents before every game. Something like that can really create a positive, polite, and friendly attitude. And again, if they do, you're really in trouble. Practice good sideline behaviors, so things like not chipping in and calls unless asked, things like that. There's some really good opportunities at training to do that. Celebrating everything. There's often, you know, one thing that I know that Laura mentioned to me about Beach World specifically, there's an amazing atmosphere of congratulating others when they did really good things. So consider some kind of celebrate everything attitude, and that means celebrating other people's greatness as well as your own. If you celebrate everything, then, you know, everyone has a more positive experience, and it may encourage people to think slightly differently about the game. Last one, communication. I think this is the one that's incredibly interesting, and we've already sort of touched on a few communication tools that you can use. Communication really goes above and beyond all of the spirit categories, because you can't have the other good categories unless you can communicate them, basically. You can't be fair and positive if you can't communicate that. Some ways that, you know, people don't necessarily always think about are body language. Like, just teach people to have good body language. Often people say, hey, be positive. Like, something as simple as like hands off hips or hands on hips. do something fun and dumb that teaches people what good body language actually looks like, and then encourage them to use it throughout. Again, something like always asking the sideline for feedback for things, or introducing team-based policies. Something where make a rule that you have to take 5 seconds before you can discuss any foul call. So count, like literally stand there in silence and count to 5 before you can discuss a foul call. No one's gonna be upset that you took 5 seconds to take a breath and really think about it. Just don't turn your back to them or whatever. Really, this is one that I really want to focus on just really quickly. Give training to your spirit captains. Think about, if you want to go to one extreme, think about sending them to like a conflict resolution course or giving them access to online learning tools that allow them to do that. That's at a really extreme level. But even something as simple as talking to them about what the responsibility actually entails, we often don't do that, and it's something that's come up in terms of our youth leadership session before. It's really important to give people scope. Are there any AFA resources? There's plenty of Wolfgang resources. One of the things about communicating our game, get people people to pitch Ultimate to a small group of people, just give do some unusual communication-based exercises that put people a little bit out of their comfort zone, and that will actually really help you, I think, in letting people express their opinions rather than and things and closing up. And these are hand signals of regret. Okay.
I think,
sure. Can't do it.
We kind of touched on it before, but like language is also really important, yeah, especially in a world context when you're playing potentially a lot of countries that don't have English as their first language. I was even actually like, can be quite intimidating for people who don't really understand English to begin with. So that's something to go ahead and learn.
Max, are you good for a couple of minutes?
Yeah, yeah, okay. I'm going to blow through this to give you a sense, and we can talk about it later at the pub. But asking yourself in terms of what you should focus on, in terms of how you actually attack spirit as a coach. Step one, known issues. If you have known issues, address them first. I'm gonna go through all these four real quick. The appetite, how hungry is your team, as a metaphor for spirit improvement, and how can you also affect that as a coach? What level are you playing at? Are you a nationals team? Are you an international team? Are you a league team? And be opportunistic. So, known issues. There's lots that we could get into here, but it's probably worth talking about. It may be that you have a known team-wide issue, that your team has you're viewed in a certain way by the overall community. If you know that as a coach, I think it's, again, a responsibility and an opportunity to change that. That's on body contact here. I don't know who the one person is in this one. Is it multiple people? Is it one person? I think I could do a whole nother session probably on dealing with one guy or one girl who's on your team. But I think it's worth saying that as a coach, you're probably going to need to be comfortable. What you need is that if you want to deal with one person, is probably a strategy that is not just directed at that person, but is directed by the team. You're never going to, as a coach, be able to get to one person directly unless you have a group of individuals who probably have a known set of values that they're working towards that they can then self-police and help you address this person. You can't say to one person, hey, you're being too physical. If you don't have a set of team goals that maybe you can go back to and say, we agreed that we were not going to be this physical, or it makes it easier to deal with one person. If you say we're going to be well-spirited in this category or this category, if one person is breaking those rules, it's much easier for the cohort as a group to start addressing that issue. And this is why, before anything, you should probably think about what your values and culture are as a team, as a club, as a whatever, to deal with that one person. What's the appetite? So talk about your team values. Find the change makers in your particular group and target them. Work out how you can get to certain people and get to the team through that. I think it's really important to teach best practice in terms of spirit, even if the appetite for change in terms of spirit might not be as high as you would like it to be. Because I think you'll be surprised at the kind of things that often stick when you give people the highest level of spirit coaching that you possibly can. You may say your team is not actually, our spirit's pretty good, we don't need to focus on it. I think by giving people a few different ways of looking at it, I think you can really affect things, and that's dependent on your style as a coach. That's worth thinking about your own values. The level that you're coaching at really depends, but I don't think you should think, I'm a coach of a league team, or I'm a captain of a league team, or I'm a leader in any social league, for example. I don't think you should then say, well, spirit's not my concern, or that you can't actually work in some of these techniques into those kind of levels. Spirit at Worlds, as we just talked about in terms of international communication and thousand body contact and all that stuff, Spirit at Worlds is the hardest thing, because Ultimate at Worlds is the hardest thing. The level of difficulty with spirit will probably increase with the amount, with the stakes. So don't be afraid of getting it wrong. And that goes to my last point, which is to be opportunistic. Always train like you want to play, and do the same thing with spirit. Don't simply allow calls to, don't allow a contested call at training to just go unlitigated. Discuss it. Have a policy where you discuss every call at training, because you're not going to get other opportunities to discuss calls with players in an open environment like that. Find opportunities. There are opportunities all around to teach really good spirit. Empower your athletes to be better spirited, and yeah, basically don't let wanting to be at the highest level stop finding small ways in which you can generate change in terms of spirit. Again, I feel like I could talk about this the whole time, but please enjoy coaching spirit, and I'm willing to talk about it.